put together a message and wept over the revelation of the love of the Father. And I understand that many of us don't have a great picture of the love of the Father. You know, my story is that I knew Jesus, and I loved Jesus, and I loved to be in the presence of Jesus, and I loved the interaction with the Holy Spirit and the way that He moved and ministered and comforted. But the Father was harsh. He was distant. He was hard to know. But the Word says that Jesus is the exact representation of the Father. He is the image of the Father. He came to reveal the Father. While we were in our sin, He died for us. And it's, you know, we can, for those of us who've grown up in church, if y'all want to sit, it's okay. But I want you to stay in this posture. And I don't, y'all can stay close and you keep playing. I want you to stay in this posture, okay? It's very easy for us to get distracted. The enemy is the king of distraction. But there's something that happens in the presence of the Lord that doesn't happen in any other way, in any other place, but in His presence. And we can grow up in church and we can hear all about how much God loves us and all of the truth and all of the scriptures. And that is good. It's not, I'm not diminishing the authority of the Word. But if it's only knowledge, it doesn't change us. Without the power of the Holy Spirit, the Word actually says, in the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. The Word is alive. It is the very essence of Jesus, of our Father. But we often read it to get our checklist. We read it to know the things we need to do so we can live our good Christian life for Him. And some of you are so tired and weary because you are living for Him. And He's actually said, I want you to live from Me. From Me. It changes everything when we learn that we're not merely supposed to live for Him. I'm not saying that we don't live for Him. But when we live from Him, holiness is a byproduct of living from Him. Service and our worship is a byproduct of living from Him, not for Him. When we live for Him, we come in here and we do the thing and we wonder why nothing changes in our life. Because we're doing it in our strength, in our ability, we're striving, and we will never measure up. We won't. We can't. But the beautiful thing is that we do not have to. Jesus bore the weight of all the sin, past, present, and future. He bore the weight. When was the last time that the revelation and the reality of that wrecked you to your core? That you couldn't just come in here and sing these songs and go through the motions and not be overwhelmed with the revelation of what He did. God is holy and he's just, and sin required punishment. It required a payment. But he made a way for that through Jesus. He made a way. There's a word called propitiation. And it's what Jesus did. He bore the wrath so that there's, it's in my notes, but I don't know exactly where the passage is, where it talks about how Jesus came full of grace and full of truth. Full of grace and full of truth. That phrase began to ring over in my spirit. And I was like, what does that mean? Like, what is it? And I came across a message, and he was talking about that. And he was talking about that the truth, God had to remain true to who he is. That sin had to be punished. There had to be a payment for it. There had to be a penalty. But he made a way through Jesus, and he satisfied all of that. And when we surrender our lives to Jesus, we become a new creation. But how many of us actually live that way? We struggle because the enemy likes to mess with us. He likes to remind us of our past. It's not the Father reminding us of our shortcomings. It's not the Father reminding us of how we've missed it. It's not the Father reminding us of how we can't get it right. It's the enemy. He wants to bring into question our identity. And I was reading through some passages. This is going to be different. I'll just tell you. We have some amazing teachers of the word, and they will teach you. For those of you who need a good teaching, they will teach you, I promise, with all the Greek and Hebrew. And I have lots of that in there, but I can't make sense of it. You couldn't make sense of it. It's in about 12 different places, 12 different notebooks. And so this is just me. And Pastor Tanya gave me permission to be me. And it's the only way that this works, because I don't actually really like this. So I was reading. Let me grab my big Bible, because I did make a bunch of notes in here. There's just some things that I've probably read before. Is this going to mess with y'all if I do this? And I don't know if this will wreck you quite like it did me. I've been in this place of just awe about Jesus, just in awe of him. He's just revealing who he is, and in that revealing who the Father is. And so I was reading, like, what happened, you know, in the beginning, whenever everything was perfect and beautiful, and we, Adam and Eve, their identity and their, like, it was perfect. They went and messed stuff up. But I just want to show you how the enemy works a little bit here. So in Genesis 3, it talks about the serpent was more crafty than any other beast of the field, which the Lord God had made. And he said to the woman, "Indeed, has God said, you shall not eat from any tree in the garden." Pay attention. And the woman said to the serpent, "From the trees of the garden we may eat." So he came in with a lie, because that's not what God said, right? He gave him a specific tree they couldn't eat from. And the woman said to the serpent, "From the trees of the garden we may eat. But from the fruit of the tree which is in the middle of the garden, God has said, you shall not eat from it or touch it, lest you die." And the serpent said to the woman, "You surely shall not die, for God knows in the day you eat from it, your eyes will be open, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food and that it was a delight to the eyes, that the tree was desirable to make one wise, she took from its fruit and ate, and she gave also to her husband with her, and he ate. Then the eyes of both of them were opened, and they knew that they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves loin coverings. And in 2:25, the last verse, it says, "And the man and his wife were both naked and were not ashamed." After this happens, it says, "Then they knew they were naked, and so they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves loin coverings." Last night, sitting in my closet, just some things were like, I wrote down, shame entered. And then they heard the sound of the Lord walking in the garden in the cool of the day. And the man and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the trees of the garden. Fear entered. Then the Lord called to them. Well, and I didn't get to that part yet. I gave it away. And said to them, "Where are you?" And he said, "I heard the sound of thee in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, so I hid myself." Fear entered. And he said, "Who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree which I commanded you not to eat?" And the man said, "The woman who thou gave me to be with, she gave me the she gave from the tree, and I ate." And the Lord said to the woman, "What is it that you've done?" And the woman said to the serpent, or said to God, "The serpent deceived me, and I ate." Blame entered. Satan twisted God's words, caused Eve to question the truthfulness of God, the goodness of God, the very words that he said. "You won't die. God's a liar. He doesn't really mean what he says." So then you read on a little bit, but this part just, it struck me, and I just wept, because this is before Jesus came. So he's talking about some things. There's some consequences, and the Lord is giving them the consequences of, you know, what's going to take place. And verse 21 says, "And the Lord God made garments of skin from animals for Adam and his wife, and he clothed them." God covered their nakedness. He covered their shame. Now, it doesn't say that he sacrificed an animal. Some people like to say this is, you know, what that means and foreshadow, and it certainly could foreshadow Christ. It doesn't say that in the text, and I don't like to read things that are not there into it. But it does say that he made clothes for them. They had already made their own clothes. They sewed some leaves together, right? And God covered them in their nakedness, even in that space. It's before Jesus ever came. And it just struck me. It's a picture of the nature of God, our Father, even in the midst of when they sinned, right in the middle of the biggest goof up in the history of humanity. None of us have messed up worse than that one, right? None of us. That was a biggie. Clearly, Jesus made a way. And, you know, a girl who's all about holiness and righteousness and all of that can get nervous when you start talking about the grace of God, because it's been really abused in our church culture. It's been watered down. It's been given to people as a license to interpret the word the way they want to live the way they want to, and to say that, you know what, you're going to be okay in the end. It's not what the word says. Grace is not something that just helps us kind of be better. Grace is not a license for us to sin. Grace is what makes us new. When we understand what it is what makes us new creatures. It creates creations. It empowers us to live the life that He's called us to live. It's what we live from when we're living from Him, is that revelation of the grace of God that enables us. But some of us just, we are so unsure in our identity that we keep going back to the, man, I'm a sinner who just messed up. I mean, we all did. But we can live from that place. And then we're just in this cycle of trying harder and failing and trying harder and failing and trying harder and failing, to where we just kind of like maybe go like, what's the point? Right? Because it's backwards. It's not in our own ability. It's not in our own strength. It's in Jesus. It's in what He did. And if we could ever grasp the depth and the width and the magnitude of that, we would just live differently. See, I told y'all it's in like a bunch of different places, and I got to remember where they're. Something that I want to, I'm probably not going to use that, but I'll try to stand up so y'all can see me some. You know, it's rooted, this, where we struggle in a lack of to understanding our identity, understanding sonship, and in I think it's in is it Matthew? Let me see, or Luke, where Jesus is baptized by John the Baptist. It's in here. I'll find it in just a minute. Maybe I wrote it here. Actually, it's in this one. Matthew 3:16 and 17. Jesus is baptized, and we see by John the Baptist, and we see the Holy Spirit descend in the form of a dove and rest on Jesus. And then a voice, the voice of the Father, says, "This is my beloved Son in whom I'm well pleased." Jesus knew He was the Son of God, right? He knew who He was. The Father still affirmed it, and probably more so for everybody else who was watching necessarily than for Jesus, because He knew. But He knew what He had to face, and He knew the separation He was going to experience, right? And He had to experience the things that He went through as human, understanding that separation whenever He bore the weight of the sin of humanity and being separated from the Father. He had to understand all of those things for the word to be true, that He understands everything that we experience in this human life, yet still fully God. It's incredible to try and wrap your mind around. But then if you, so that's in the end of chapter 3. Then in chapter 4, Jesus is immediately led by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tested, to be tempted. And Satan comes to Him and offers all these things. And in there he says, if you're the Son of God, then do this. If you're the Son of God, do this. He questioned, right? He came to sow doubt, to question who he was as his son. And then you can just hop on down a little bit later in Matthew. And the disciples are asking Jesus to teach them to pray. And the very first thing he says is, our Father. He doesn't say, righteous judge. He is that. He doesn't say, holy God Almighty, King of the universe. He is all that. But the very first thing that Jesus taught us in how to commune and talk to our Father was, Father, our Father, our Father. And like I said a little while ago, some of us have a hard time with that picture. And there are different reasons why we may struggle. Some of it is natural life, right? Like father figures or leaders in our life who have been less than loving or kind, or have beyond that been abusive or hurtful or neglectful, right? There's real pain. There's real pain. So we struggle, right, to comprehend it sometimes. Some of us, we had good fathers. Maybe they were not super nurturing or loving, but they were good providers, they were kind, they were, you know, all the things. We still struggle, some of us, because back in Genesis, we were all kind of orphaned. And Jesus, over and over again, came to give us a picture and an example of communing with the Father, of understanding the Father, of relating to the Father, of knowing the Father, drawing close to him. And I didn't want to do a whole talk on all the things about an orphan heart. But it just means that we struggle sometimes to receive the love of the Father. We struggle to believe what he says. And the only thing that I know that fixes it is the revelation of his love to you directly. I can give you all kinds of points and keys and strategy, but it's actually a revelation from him. It's his voice. It's when you hear him speak to you. You're my daughter. I love you. I've chosen you. I've accepted you. I can tell you that all day long. But when we hear it from him, it changes it. It makes it personal. It makes it real. It makes it go from here where we're trying to get it to here. And I believe tonight that the Father is going to reveal to you, those of you who need a revelation. And man, I've had fresh revelation, new revelation. It's deeper revelation, like deeper. That's probably the correct word. Deeper revelation. The more that I look at Jesus, the more I see who Jesus is. I've just been like fascinated with Jesus. And the more that I see him and read about him and encounter him, the more I grasp and understand the revelation of the heart of the Father for me. And it's transformative. When we don't understand that, some of the ways that we might respond can be in striving, perfectionism. We're trying to be the best us in our own strength and dependence. There's a lot of even good or faith-based books that will give you all of the be your best you and live your best life. And I'm not saying God doesn't want you to live your best life, but often those are like keys to like how you can do something to live your best life, right? And it can turn into performance and striving, and we're seeking to gain approval. And it can be in many areas of our life. I'm by nature kind of a little bit of an achiever. I like a good challenge. I like a good, you tell me I can't do something, I'll watch me. Just by nature. And I'm not saying that that's not bad. It doesn't have its place in situations and circumstances, but it doesn't have a place as daughters with our Father. Another thing might be substitutes, perversion, any substitute, idolatry. That can be anything. It really can. Anything that we look to feed a void, to find acceptance, anything that we look to try and fill that emptiness, that void. It could be food. It could be exercise. It could be shopping. It could be actual sexual sin. It could just be any number of things, right? Or the other thing that sometimes happens is passivity. We just decide we can't measure up, so we give up, right? We just give up. We just quit trying. We kind of like hope that like our salvation, you know, is good. Like we've prayed the prayer and we're gonna scoot into heaven by the skin of our teeth, but we're just kind of not. We're not pursuing His love. We're not pursuing the heart of the Father. We're not pursuing a relationship with Him. And we don't need to strive for it, but there is an act of our will that we do have to engage. Like we have to take responsibility. We have to pursue the Lord. We have to seek the Lord. We have to make time to let Him speak. We do have to be in the Word, because the Bible says to be transformed by the renewing of your mind. But we have to, even how we read the Word has to look different. It has to look different. It has to look at it as, this is Jesus. This is the Father. This is life. It is living. It's breath. And when you read it with that revelation, that understanding, that it's not just information on a page. It's a book full of stories of how God spoke to His children, to His sons and daughters. That's all it is Him speaking to the apostles and them sharing the story, and Him speaking to the prophets and them sharing. It is all about God speaking to His children. But we read it often as a list of rules, as our checkbox, as all the things I have to do to get it right. And it becomes burdensome because we're trying to keep the letter of the law. And the Word says that the letter of the law kills, but the Spirit gives life. This becomes revelation when the Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit, breathes on it and it becomes living to you. So you don't just read, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever perish but would not perish but have eternal life." That's just a great story. But God sent Jesus for me. Jesus took my place on the cross. I deserved that punishment, but his great love made a way. I think that for many of us who've spent much time in the church, the gospel message, really anything, can just become like so familiar. I've been reading different passages in different translations, and I know there's a lot of people who have opinions about different ones, and that's okay. But there's just been something like that it's just done in me when I read, you know, a passage in 1 John in the Message translation or in the Amplified, where it just says it a little bit different, that it's like not so familiar to me, that it's like, oh, there's some life on that, right? Because we can hear those things over and over again, and it becomes so familiar that it loses the power and the freshness and the revelation of what it is, what he's saying. And he, being serving Jesus is not boring. It's not mundane. It shouldn't be. It should be new and fresh and alive every day. Right? Because he's infinite. The vastness of who he is beyond what we will ever comprehend on this side of eternity. And then we will spend eternity trying to comprehend it and understand it. Let's just wait for a moment and see where the Lord wants to go next. First John 3, out of the Message. I just want you to, Holy Spirit, we're asking that you speak to your daughters, that you speak to us. Father, we want to hear your voice. So just want you to ask him. I'm just going to read through some different passages of scripture about the love of the Father and the love of Jesus. There's a whole bunch in there, and I don't know what I'll read yet. But I just want you to ask him to speak afresh to you. What marvelous love the Father has extended to us. Just look at it. We're called children of God. That's who we really are. But that's also why the world doesn't recognize us or take us seriously, because it has no idea who he is or what he's up to. But friends, that's exactly who we are. Children of God. And that's only the beginning. Who knows how we'll end up? What we know is that when Christ is openly revealed, we'll see him. And in seeing him, become like him. All of us who look forward to his coming, stay ready with the glistening purity of Jesus' life as a model for our own. All who indulge in a sinful life are dangerously lawless, for sin is a major disruption of God's order. Surely you know that Christ showed up in order to get rid of that sin. There is no sin in him, and sin is not part of his program. No one who lives deeply in Christ makes a practice of sin. None of those who do practice sin have taken a good look at Christ. They've got him all backwards. So my dear children, don't let anyone divert you from the truth. It's that person who acts right who is right, just as we see it lived out in the righteous Messiah. Those who make a practice of sin are straight from the devil, the pioneer in the practice of sin. The Son of God entered the scene to abolish the devil's ways. People conceived and brought into life by God don't make a practice of sin. How could they? God's seed is deep within them, making them who they are. It's not the nature of the God-born to practice and parade sin. Here's how you tell the difference between God's children and the devil's children. The one who won't practice righteous ways isn't from God, nor is the one who won't love brother or sister. A simple test. For this is the original message we heard. We should love each other. We must not be like Cain, who joined the evil one and then killed his brother. And why did he kill him? Because he was deep in the practice of evil, while the acts of his brother were righteous. So don't be surprised, friends, when the world hates you. This has been going on for a long time. The way we know we've been transferred from death to life is that we love our brothers and sisters. Anyone who doesn't love is as good as dead. Anyone who hates a brother or sister is a murderer. And you know very well that eternal life and murder don't go together. This is how we've come to understand and experience love. Christ sacrificed his life for us. This is why we ought to live sacrificially for our fellow believers and not just be out for ourselves. If you see your brother or sister in need and have the means to do something about it, but turn a cold shoulder and do nothing, what happens to God's love? It disappears, and you made it disappear. My dear children, let's not talk about love. Let's practice real love. This is the only way we'll know we're living truly, living in God's reality. It's all the way to shut down debilitating self-criticism, even when there's something to it. For God is greater than our worried hearts and knows more about us than we do ourselves. And friends, once that's taken care of, we're no longer accusing or condemning ourselves. We're bold and free before God. We're able to stretch out our hands and receive what we ask for because we are doing what he said, doing what pleases him. Again, this is God's command to believe in his person, in his personally named son, Jesus Christ. He told us to love each other in line with the original command. As we keep his commands, we live deeply and surely in him, and he lives in us. And this is how we experience his deep and abiding presence in us by the Spirit he gave us. Oh, it's just so beautiful. Different words, right? Just sounds a little different, hits you a little bit differently. There's just one other thing I want to talk about. I actually had written down all these like great little like points or headers, and it was like the pursuit of God's love and the proof of God's love, the promise of God's love, the power of his love. But there was one that was the protection of God's love. God protects us through discipline. And Hebrews 12:6 says, "Have you forgotten the exhortation that addressed you as sons? My son, do not regard lightly the discipline of the Lord, nor be weary when approved by him, because the Lord disciplines the ones he loves and chastens everyone he accepts as sons." And I looked up those words, and the word discipline and reprove have different meanings. And I think discipline is pronounced padia, but it basically talks about the education or training, the whole training and education of a child. It speaks to instruction. And then reprove is a different word that talks about rebuke or finding a fault. I think back to the passage in Genesis where Satan came and he basically convinced Eve that God was withholding something good from him or from them. And in that, she was deceived and she disobeyed. He convinced her that God was withholding something good. Can I tell you that his boundaries, that his parameters that he has set for our life are his protection? And we sometimes think there's, but we sometimes don't want or like the discipline of the Lord because we don't understand it. We understand it as punishment for our bad behavior. But discipline speaks to training, instructing, teaching. We teach our kids not to run in the street because it's not safe. God teaches us in his word how we're supposed to live our lives because he understands the dangers outside of that, right? So what's the difference between punishment and discipline? Punishment is the result of God's justice, which, remember, Jesus bore. Discipline is a result of his love. That passage says he disciplines those he loves. You're considered a son when the Lord disciplines you, when he instructs you. Punishment is for the subjects of wrath, the sons of disobedience, those who will refuse him. One day, they will experience separation and eternity. If you haven't surrendered your life to Jesus, there is eternal punishment, but not for the believer. Jesus took the punishment. Discipline is for God's children. Punishment hurts you. Discipline strengthens you. Punishment looks backward at what you've done wrong and exacts justice. Discipline looks forward at who you were created to be and helps you get there. Jesus became our punishment, and that's the power of God's love. Some of you understand punishment in a very real way. Some of you were punished for your bad behavior, and not in a godly, loving way. Not in a way that seeks to correct and direct you, but to make you feel bad for your choices. Some of you have maybe sat in a church somewhere who's beat you over the head with all your shortcomings and your mistakes and how you'll never measure up, right? Jesus bore our punishment. And the Lord wants to heal hearts tonight. So we're just, for a moment, going to lean into this. And if that connects to you, if you have been afraid of the Father because you have experienced punishment for your bad behavior, and you have a little bit of fear of the Lord waiting for him to just whack you over the head when you get it wrong, the Lord wants to heal those places. And I believe some actual real natural life things that you've encountered, maybe some abuse, verbal, physical. The healer is in the house. And he's going to speak to you. Because it's his words that heal you. It's his truth that heals you. I can say all kinds of things, like I said, but when you hear his voice. So we're going to just say, I just want you to invite the Father into that moment, into that encounter. Maybe there's multiple things, but there's something that's coming to your mind, coming to your heart. I want you just to invite, give Jesus permission to come into that place. And ask him. So when we want to hear the Father speak, we have to ask him questions. So I want you to ask him where he was in that moment. And what he wants to say to you about it. So we're just going to wait. Holy Spirit, speak to your daughters. Wanting to bring up something that the Lord has already healed you of. So I'm not pushing you to go find something. But those of you that know you have not dealt with some things, you know. And I feel like there might be just one or two in the room that there's just some resistance because it's just too painful. or you're just a little afraid. He's a good father. He's gentle, he's kind, he's loving. He's not like a human. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. I believe that there's a couple of things that the Lord wants to do in the next few moments as we lean in, and I think I saw the worship team maybe moving close. I believe that there's some more healing of hearts that needs to take place. That you need to do business with the Father. Maybe you need someone to pray and agree with you. And we have some ladies who are going to be up here and available to pray. And prayer team, y'all should know this, but I'm just going to ask you, as you're ministering, find out specifically like what they're here for. I don't have to go into long detail, but and I want you to have them engage with their words, okay? So just be led by the Spirit in that. So I believe there's some healing. And I also believe that the Lord wants to baptize us in his love for others, for the world that doesn't know him, right? It's the kindness of the Father that leads men to repentance. It says they'll know you're Christians by your love. And I see a lot of not love in the church right now. I see a lot of uncovering and pointing fingers and name calling. And don't get me wrong, I believe that there is a righteous exposure of sin and things that are not right. But I also believe that the primary person responsible for doing that job is the Father. And we must understand that when he is exposing things and bringing it to light, it's because he loves that person. And he is doing it because he wants them restored. He wants them right. Right in the Bible says that he corrects and disciplines. He's trying to bring them back. And there is a lot of things happening in the body of the Christ of Christ that are grieving. And if we're not grieved by it, we need a baptism of his love because the Father is grieved by it. There are a lot of just things that I see that I'm wanting to know, where's the love? Where is the love? Jesus, the Father, will correct and discipline, and he does expose. He's righteous, and he will. Like, he will hold into account those who need to be held into account. But our job is to restore people to their Father, to restore them to right relationship. And so I believe that he's going to baptize us in love. Love for the world, love for our brothers and sisters, love for those people who've hurt us and done us wrong. It doesn't mean we have to be in relationship with unsafe people, but we have to forgive and we have to trust the Father with them. because he died for them too. His blood was shed for them too. And there are those that are evil and wicked who will not ever choose to repent, and God will deal with them in his time and final judgment, and maybe before. So if you will stand, prayer team, if you'll come forward. Oh, Jesus, we thank you. We thank you for your great love. We thank you that you have come and revealed the Father to us. And Abba, we're so grateful that you call us your daughters, that we can approach the throne of grace and find help in time of need, because Jesus tore the veil. He paid the price. He tore the veil that separated us, and we can enter your presence freely. So we thank you. Father, we thank you. You're so good. Those are not just cute words that we sing. It is the truth. You are so good. Father, we are asking that you give us your heart, that as we lean in and as you heal our heart and as you reveal your heart to us, that Father, our heart beats with love and passion and compassion for the world and for our brothers and sisters. We're asking for a baptism of the love of the Father to come and fall in this place. We're asking that you would reveal your heart for the world, that you would make us, Lord Jesus, those who love deeply the things that you love. We thank you for your healing in this room. Heal our hearts, Jesus.
Because I have seen your face. Your love. There is There's nothing like your love.
He loves.
to worship you, I live.
Do you remember in the seventh grade when you go to the school dance and all the boys are on one side of the room and all the girls are on the other side of the room and there's just like that weird math teacher and the coach dancing in the middle? And everybody's like, oh my gosh, that's so gross. Sometimes that's what it feels like here. First night of conference, it's a little awkward. We don't all know each other. We've got San Antonio here. We've got New Mexico here. We've got people from all over, and we don't necessarily recognize everybody, but I just want to tell you something. This is a safe place, and we're not here to be mean girls, right? We're here to do business because God is rising up women in this time because there is something He needs for us to do. But we can't do what He's called us to do if we're bound. So it requires freedom. And if you do not grasp the love the Father has for you, there is a space for the lie of the enemy to be planted and begin to grow into harvest in your life. And that's why this message is so important, because we can prophesy, we can sing, we can speak with tongues of angels, but if it's not rooted and grounded in love, it is pointless. It is meaningless. One version says it is like a clanging gong in the ears of God. He is not pleased with our humanistic efforts to look religious. He wants everything we do to be springboarded from love. Well, you can't give what you don't have. You can't walk out what you don't have. We have to grab hold of this. So I want to encourage you tonight, as we move into tomorrow morning and tomorrow afternoon and tomorrow night, don't hold back. If you don't need to wear makeup, don't wear makeup. You'll cry it off anyway, right? If you can't get in the floor in it, if you can't, don't wear it. If you're thinking more about your heels than you are Jesus, take them off. All right? We're not here to play games. We're not here for all that stuff. We're here for Jesus. We're here to be equipped. We're here to be empowered. We're here to hear His voice so that we can do what He's called us to do. He has an assignment for you, ladies, every single one of you. And there may be a triage that you need to enter so that He can do a work in you so that you can be free to do what He's called you to do. So get out of the bleachers. Come on down the floor. Don't see this anymore like seventh grade dance. We need to see this as ballroom dance lessons. And the instructor says, come here, I'm going to teach you step by step. We're going to do this together. And you're going to look weird, but guess what? So does everybody else. Because we're all learning and we're all growing and we're all figuring this out. So this is a safe place for you, okay? Tonight is the first night and the opening night. And it is absolutely right that the first heart that we're grabbing from the Father, the first message from the heart of the Father tonight is that of His love for us. Do you love me? Yes, no, maybe. Can I tell you? He circles yes every time. Every time. Every time. So let's lift our hands and let's sing a love song to the Lord tonight. And as we're worshiping together, I just want to encourage you. We're just going to sing for just a minute. Whatever is holding you back, if it's pride, if it's fear, if it's just the awkwardness of the room, whatever it is, will you just say to the Lord, hey, I'm laying this down. Just shake it off, get out of it, and just say, Lord, I'm here for you. I'm not here for all that chick stuff. I'm not here for all the drama stuff. I'm just here for you. All right, so let's lift our hands and let's pray. Father, we thank you tonight for every woman in this room. And I cover every heart that has received tonight with the blood of Jesus. And I thank you, Father God, that the impartation of love that has gone forth to each woman, it's not like bouncing off of them and coming back, but Father, it is taking root in their hearts tonight. I pray, Father God, that even in their going home, even in their laying down in their bed, even in their sleep, Father God, you are continuing to grow and develop a revelation of the love that you have for us, Father. I pray tonight, Lord, that any root the enemy has that has caused them to hold back and say, oh, I don't know if I can do this, I come against that in the name of Jesus. And we say, be loosed and set free into the fullness that God has for you tonight. We thank you, Father, for your goodness. We thank you for your love. We thank you for your kindness toward us, that yet while we were in sin, you died for us. You made a sacrifice in our place. You took the punishment we deserved. And we're eternally grateful, Lord. Eternally grateful, Lord. So we sing a love song to you, Father. We set our affection on you. We set our hearts on you. We set our minds on you, Father God, to set the tone for everything that happens after this, Father. It's all about you, Jesus. It's all about you, Jesus.
Jesus, we love you. Oh, how we love you. You are the one our hearts adore.
Oh yes, we do.
Jesus, we love you. Oh, how we love you. You are the one. Our devotion.
devotion poured out on the feet of Jesus. We love you. Oh, how we love you. You are the one our hearts adore.
I'll sing it to him one more time.
Jesus, we love you.
We really love you, yes.
Oh, how we love you. You are the one our hearts adore. Jesus, we love you. Oh, how we love. Oh, Jesus, we love you. Oh, how we love you. You are the one our hearts adore.
Come on, give him one more praise in this house tonight. Oh, yeah.
A wonderful night to worship with all of you. Thank you so much for coming. Let's all give Abigail a great big clap and hallelujah, girl. You rocked it. Thank you. Such a good word. All right, so where's your ticket? Everybody got your ticket? We're gonna give two gifts away. Who's got the winning ticket? Here we go. Up, Jessica, come in. Be the picker. All right, 598-940. Last three, 940. Who's got that? 940. Oh! Congratulations. All right, let's pick another one. Yep. 598-975. Woo-hoo! All right. Awesome. So, Pastor Tanya just showed me the QR code on our little name tags. Takes us right to the schedule. So if you have any questions about tomorrow, this is a great reference. So just get online and get your schedule. Doors open at 9:30 in the morning. So we will see y'all in the morning with smiling face and full of joy. We're so excited for what's to come. Good night, y'all. Make sure you take everything with you because we're going to clean up and get ready, everything ready for in the morning. Thank you.
Oh, hallelujah.
Oh, hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Oh, hallelujah.
Oh, hallelujah.
Our God saves.
Our God saves.
Oh, hallelujah.
Oh, hallelujah.
Highest praises.
Highest praises.
Oh, hallelujah.
Oh, hallelujah.
We give thanks.
We give thanks.
praises.
Highest praises. So good, you've been so good. I thank you, Lord. I thank you. My heart is full. My heart is full. I love you, Lord. I love you. You've been so good. You've been so good. I thank you, Lord. I thank you. My heart is full. My heart is. So good, I thank you, Lord, I thank you. My heart is full, my heart is full. I love you, Lord, I love you. Thank you, Lord, for saving me. Thank you, Lord, for saving me. Oh.